be able to go. I want us to pray together if we can this morning. Father, first of all, I want to thank you, God, for the privilege today that you give us to worship. And it is truly a privilege. There are not a lot of places, God, in this world where we have the freedoms that we have here in America. And we realize that all those freedoms came with a very high price. And today, and this weekend, we celebrate that freedom. We recognize that in the midst of having that freedom, that people take it and they use it in a way that harms others because they have the freedom to say and do just about what they want to say and do. But yet, as a nation, Lord, we are grateful. As a church, I'm grateful. Because God, along with that freedom that we have in you, we have the greatest freedom of all. Whether we're living here or in Saudi Arabia, God, we can be free in Christ. And I thank you for that freedom. I pray today, God, that you will alert us to you and make us mindful of the fact that you are not only there for us, but God, you are there with us and that your grace is sufficient today for us. And for that, I am grateful. In Jesus' name, amen. In your handout today, you have in your worship bulletin, sermon notes for today. And because yesterday was the 4th and today is the 5th, and this is a pivotal time in our nation's history, we're at a place where revisionists are trying to redefine what America is all about and trying to tell us what America is all about. And yet our founding fathers are the very ones who has helped us to establish this great nation. And just as a precursor to anything I may say about them, all of our founding fathers were flawed to the core. I mean, to the core. They practiced, did things that were not socially acceptable today in regards to slavery or the owning of people as property. Now, granted, they were flawed. As every governmental leader today is flawed. They may not be flawed in the same way, but every person is flawed. When you read the Gospels and you read about all of those who wrote and those who God chose to be a part of a movement that would shape the world, every one of those people are flawed. So therefore, they are flawed. The historical leaders of our country are flawed. The biblical writers, or the narrative writers in the New Testament are flawed. Those of us who are sitting in this room, with the exception of Carolyn, are flawed. We're all flawed, okay? But what we stand in need of as flawed people is a redeemer. And what our nation needs is a redeemer. There are a couple of things I'm going to run through today and kind of get to where we are and at the end and talk about how that we have all of these amazing freedoms in our life as followers of Christ. But when you think about the history of this great nation, in July the 2nd, 1776, the colonies came together and they voted to announce and declare that they would accept nothing less than absolute freedom from Britain or England. They said nothing less. We are declaring to you, and we're putting you on notice, that we are not going to take it any longer. Now, they came together, and they made that declaration. On July the 4th, they made some exceptions and some adjustments to the text. And then after making those adjustments, the final wording was ratified and signed by 56 members of the continental colonies. And yet, they declared their freedom. And guess what they had to do after they declared it? They had to earn it. You know, we understand how that works, right? You may, at once upon a time, declare that you're going to quit smoking. Guess what you had to do? You had to quit smoking. You may have declared once upon a time, I'm not going to talk negatively about someone. You may have declared that. Guess what you had to do? You had to literally stop doing it. You may declare that I'm not going to watch anything or see anything that's inappropriate in my eyes or God's eyes. And yet you may have declared that, but you had to earn the right to say I declared it by stop doing it. And can I tell you, no exception. On July the 4th, when those 56 signers of the Declaration of Independence got together with that ratified document. They made a declaration, and that declaration was this, that whatever it takes, we are seceding from you. You will not run our life any longer. So therefore, July the 4th is a day that we celebrate our independence. People that have helped us to celebrate our independence are people like Patrick Henry. We know Patrick Henry from that person who said, give me liberty or give me what? Death. I will take nothing less than my own life for my liberty. Patrick Henry made that statement. He also said that it cannot be emphasized too strongly, he said, or too often, that this great nation was founded, but not religionists, but by Christians. Not on religion, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. Patrick Henry said that. Here he is, made that statement. That I know why this country was founded. If someone should know, it would be someone closer to it. And he knew that our nation was founded, not by religionists, but by Christians. Also, a person by the name of George Washington, you may know him. You may have seen his monument recently on the news. Been pulled down. But what did George Washington say? Do not let anyone claim tribute to American patriotism if they even attempt to remove religion from politics. In fact, the 13 colonies that succeeded were colonies that were made up of, many of them, of Christian leaders and of pastors that were part of the claimers and the signers of the 56 signers of the Declaration. Thomas Jefferson said, the First Amendment has created a wall of separation between church and state, but that wall is a one-directional wall. It keeps the government from running the church, but it makes sure that Christian principles will always stay in government. You notice that that monument's been pulled down. I mean, here he is saying that that directional wall was one direction. The government cannot impede the life of the church. But the church has every responsibility to impede the life of the government. And then in the early 1940s, the Supreme Court ruled and tried to change the policy of the Constitution and to amend that very policy. People like John Adams says, we have no government armed with power capable of contending with human passions unbridled by morality and religion. Our Constitution was made for a moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the government or any other. In other words, our Constitution does not exist so that radicals can run their agenda through our life. It doesn't even qualify to help govern a radical, rogue nation, but it's for a Christian nation. Our founding fathers, on the other hand, had several declarations when they signed the Declaration of Independence. They, first of all, they pledged their all. What did they say? We mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. All 56 signers, they did something. They put their life on the line. They said, we're not just going to declare it. But if it means our life to achieve it, we'll give our life to do it. We declare mutually, we pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. The founding fathers understood that freedom of all things has a price. When you study the Revolutionary War, which is quite fascinating when you study it, I mean, you study things like how many Americans were killed in action and how many were wounded and how many were taken prisoners and all of that. But what you fail to recognize is that of those 56 signers and framers of the Declaration of Independence, the majority of them suffered greatly. They suffered. Many of them died. Several of them died in prison. 12 of them, their homes were ransacked and burned. Sons were killed. Their own children were killed. 9 of the 56 died from wounds in battle. And yet, as a result of that bold declaration in their life, they understood that freedom has a high price. We would not be free today if people didn't understand the price of freedom. That freedom has a price. Freedom not only has a price, but our founding fathers understood that freedom has a reward, a great reward. What was the outcome of this Revolutionary War? Britain finally succeeded, and there was a treaty that was signed, and America was free, free. We've grown from that freedom since July the 4th, 1776, when it was declared, till several years later when it was finally achieved. But what we did understand through all of that, there is a reward to freedom. Of those 56 signers, two became presidents, became president, 10 became U.S. congressmen, 19 became judges, 16 became governors, and all of that happened in a free nation, a free nation. Now, those of us that are looking at and trying to put our mind around what has happened in the last several weeks, we fear that our freedom is eroding. We fear that our the greatest thing that we have as a nation is being taken from us, our freedoms. And yet in the midst of all of that, we're still free. We're still free. In fact, I put in your handout that the pledges that we have, that we say in our church. We pledge allegiance to the American flag by saying, "I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all." That is a process. That's a process. We want that to be a real reality in all of our lives, that liberty and justice for all. And yet, that flag has been burnt more in the last few weeks than we could ever dream. And yet that flag still stands for freedom. In our church, we have a Christian flag. And that Christian flag, which no one attacks the Christian flag, primarily because quite often the Christian church is not attacking the systemic problems of a fallen and dying world. And yet, the Christian flag says, "I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands. One Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again with life and liberty for all who believe." Can I tell you that Christian flag reminds us of the greatest freedom of all? That freedom can be taken from us, but the freedom we have in Jesus Christ can never be taken from us. That is a freedom of all freedoms. We pledge allegiance to the Christian flag. We pledge allegiance to the Bible, the Word of God. Oftentimes that pledge takes place in Bible school, and we kind of age out of that if you age out of Bible school. But if you remember, that pledge says, "I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and I will hide his word in my heart that I may not sin against God." So the pledge to the flag makes us a better citizen. The pledge to the Christian flag reminds us of what we have in Christ. The pledge to the Bible reminds us that all instruction is given by inspiration from God. It is profitable for instruction, for correction and righteousness' sake. So the Word of God becomes the basis by which we determine what is our view of our world today. And we see it through the prism of the Word of God. So with that said, I want you to look at a couple of things that I hope that speaks volumes to every one of us today. And that is, as followers of Jesus Christ, we have something that we should never forget. And that is that as followers of Jesus Christ, we had to, at some point in time, we had to pledge our all to Jesus. See, that's a pledge. When you give your life to someone, when you submit your life to someone, you're pledging your life to that person. Paul understood that. Paul understood that I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I mean, isn't that a beautiful pledge? That's the pledge of reminding that I have died. I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer am in charge of my life. He is. What does that tell you? I have pledged my all to Jesus. When you go back in the Old Testament, you find one of those historic figures of the Old Testament named Joshua. When God's children finally took the promised land, God had given it to them, and God was giving them the ability to take that land back. And now, as they were beginning to settle in the promised land, Joshua called everybody together. And when he called them together, this is what he told them. He says, "Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods of your forefathers that you worship beyond the river in the Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods of your forefathers served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." That's a pledge. That's a pledge. That was just not a group of words that was just spewed out into the open air. That was a pledge that said, "I'm declaring this with my lips, but I am going to demonstrate this with my life." Paul did the same thing in Galatians when he said that. Paul said, "I am declaring to you that I am a dead man, that I have been redeemed with a price. I'm declaring to you that I no longer live for myself, but I am declaring to you and demonstrating to you that Christ lives in me." That's the pledge. That's the pledge every day of our life, that we should wake up and declare unto God and remind ourselves afresh that I have pledged my all to Him. Everything I have, I've pledged to Him. As followers of Christ, we understand that along with that pledge, along with that declaration, also comes the responsibility of fleshing that out. So therefore, as followers of Christ, our freedom as well has a price. It has a price. What is the price? He says in the Gospel of Luke, he says, "Then he said to them all, if anyone wants to follow me or follow after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. And whoever loses his life because of me will save it. For what does it benefit someone if he gains the whole world and yet he loses or forfeits himself?" King James says, or he forfeits his own soul or loses his own soul. You know, when Jesus is writing these words in Luke, he's writing them to people that clearly understood that if you saw a man with a cross on his back and he's walking out of the town, that man ain't coming back. Because the cross was the picture of death. And yet Jesus himself said that if anyone who's going to follow after me has to take up this cross and die every day. Every day. Die to your own desires. Die to your own ambitions. Die to your own intuitions. You've got to die to it all. And learn how to live as unto Christ. He declares that. In fact, prior to that, he said in the Gospel of Luke 7, he says, "Not everyone who says unto me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Apart from me, you evildoers." One of the most sobering verses in all the Bible is found right there in verse number 21. "Not everyone who says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven." What does that tell us? There's a price. The price. What is the price? If I say I believe in him, then the evidence of that belief is demonstrated by the way that I live. But it's not he who says unto me, Lord, Lord, gets to enter into the kingdom of heaven, but it is he who does the will of my Father, who chooses to do the right thing for God. See, that's where we get caught up in this fallen world and fail to recognize that even as Christians, we struggle right here with this. Because there are days in our life that we wish that we could do a do-over, that we messed that day up real bad, and we wish we could go back and redo that day. And the very reason that we are aware of that in our life is because God lives in us, because we know Luke 7:21 to be so, that I belong to him, therefore I don't get to live any way I choose. I have to learn how to live a life that pleases him. And he tells us that very truth, that as followers of Jesus Christ, our freedom has a price. As followers of Jesus Christ, we experience the greatest freedom of all. And that freedom is found in the Gospel of John. When Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Freedom. The whole concept of freedom has been completely redefined. People that live in the freest land on planet Earth feel like they've been brought back into slavery or never have been truly free. And yet the freedom that Christ offers us is a lasting freedom. It is the greatest freedom of all. The freedom that we have in Christ. The freedom that Romans says, therefore there is now no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. That freedom that happens when Romans 8:18 says, I consider our present sufferings not worthy with the glory to be revealed in us. In other words, Paul was stating in Romans 8, no condemnation because we're in Christ. And that this present suffering cannot compare to the future I have in Christ. How do we have a future in Christ? We have freedom in Christ. There's no future without freedom. Our freedom is secure in Jesus. Our freedom is secure, as Peter said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because of his great mercy, he's given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you and for me. That is the reward of that freedom. That we have something to look forward to. And that something we have to look forward to is the recognition that we have a freedom that this world cannot take away. That even our mind, when we fail in our memory, cannot take it away. I have a good friend of mine named Sam. He lives in Melbourne. He will be 90 this month. Probably the most influential person in my entire life, as another man could be. But Sam and his wife Marie live in a retirement home in Melbourne. And Sam fell a week and a half or so ago and injured his shoulder. So he's in a rehab center. Got out of the hospital and had to go to another rehab center. His wife, Marie, is suffering from Parkinson's in a horrible way. Sam cannot remember what he had for breakfast. But I talk to Sam every day. When he answers the phone, same thing. It's a good life if you don't weaken. Same thing every day. And then all of a sudden, to break with protocol, he said, Billy, I know I'm a Christian, but I don't remember how I became a Christian. But I know I am one. I know that Jesus is with me. And I don't even know how I became a Christian. And then a 90-year-old asked the man 30 years his senior. He said, if you can't remember, does it mean I'm not a Christian anymore? I said, Sam, what do you think? And then he said the most beautiful words. Once a follower of Jesus, always a follower of Jesus. And I'm going to tell you, that's the beauty. Not even Alzheimer's can take away the joy of his salvation. That's the freedom that comes from knowing Jesus. And it comes with a price, but oh my God, whatever price you pay in this life pales into comparison to the reward that we have to look forward to in Christ Jesus. We have a reward in knowing Christ as our Savior. Let's pray. Father, thank you for these few moments we've had to worship today. Lord, help us to understand to become your child. There has to be a pledge of our life to you. You made pledges to us that you'd give us everlasting life, eternal life. But our pledge to you is that we give you our life. Whatever the sacrifice, we understand, God, that the ultimate of all the sacrifices is dying. We die to ourselves. That's the greatest price for that freedom. We learn to die because you willingly died for us. And yet, God, today, the reward of being your child, the reward of knowing that our sins are forgiven, the reward of knowing that when we go through this life, no matter what happens to us in this life, the reward of knowing that it does not happen in a vacuum. Our world is not in just groaning in anguish today without you knowing. We do not go through this life without you knowing. The reward of knowing that you're not only there for your children, but God, you're there with your children. And Father, we may not sometimes be able to put our mind around that, but God, you are able to put your arms around us. The reward of knowing that this is not all there is. Heaven awaits the child that belongs to you. May this invitation be that time that we simply just say to you, I give you my all, Jesus, today. I pledge it all to you. Regardless of the sacrifice, regardless of the price, I give it all to you for the reward of knowing you as my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to stand and Jay's going to lead us an invitation. That invitation is our response to God. It's not our response to a song, it's our response to God. It's our response to the Word of God. As God has spoken to your heart today, you know if you pledged your all to Jesus. If you have not, would you today pledge your all to Him? Do that today, would you?
My foes are many. They rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way. chaos abounding, my soul will rest in you. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm, my help is on the way, my help is on the way.
So at this time, we are going to do a little transition here to make sure we have our FM transmitter working for our outdoor drive-up service. So let's go ahead and make sure we got that. We're good. Hello, welcome in, Cedar Grove family that is out in the parking lot. If you can hear us today, can we get a loud horn blast just to make sure? One, two, three, go. There we go. I heard a horn that time. Very good. One more time. One, two, three, go. Yeah, very good. Awesome, awesome, awesome. It is good to have you guys in here with us. Billy has just concluded his sermon for the walk-in service, and we're going to worship the Lord this morning with a few songs for you today. So let's start worship this morning. This is Alive.
Lost with a broken heart, you picked me up, now I'm set apart. From the ash I am born again, forever safe in the Savior's hands. You are more than my words could say. I'll follow you, Lord, for all my days. I'll fix my eyes, follow in your ways. Forever free in unending grace. Because of you are, you are, you are my freedom. We lift you higher, your love, your love, your love, never ending. Oh, 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 you are alive in us. Nothing can take your place. You are all we need. Your love has set us free. Oh, oh. Darkest night, let your love be the shining light, breaking chains that were holding me. You sent your son down and set me free. Everything of this world will fade. I'm pressing on till I see your face. And I will live that your will be done. And I will stop till your kingdom come. Because you are. You are alive in us. Nothing can change.
very much. I wanted to let the guys in the outdoor service and the indoor service know this is not Micah Willis on our drums up here today. Micah is unfortunately out, but we got my good friend Chandler Howard, who I know from Moody High School and UAB, who's a fine percussionist, and he's playing with us today, and he was gracious enough to join us today. So give him a round of applause, if you will. Thank you for your welcome. Thank you. We're going to continue now with our lovely repeat song for you guys in the walk-in service. This is "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus."
"'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the sin of Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove to him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust him, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge beneath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and breath, his joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I put him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him. I'm so glad I learned to trust him, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that he is with me, will be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I put him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, for grace to trust him more.
Thank you. And in honor of yesterday being July the 4th, we're now going to play America the Beautiful. Patriotic song honoring this great nation that we can celebrate our freedom to worship Christ in a free place for now. May we never take that for granted. This is America the Beautiful.
Oh, beautiful for patience.
Church, we have one more song for you this morning. This is an amazing song that really deals with kind of the end of times. This song is called Revelation Song. The word revelation is not used once in it, but it has to deal with our freedom in Christ as we kind of continue on this freedom. We are free to worship God, and that is what I would like to encourage you to do as we sing, as we sing this song for you today. Let's sing Revelation Song.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.